them too loudly without running the risk of slipping down into their chest register, thereby undermining the creative tension of this quite loud passage. Therefore, Mozart assigned the oboe, the task of maintaining the registral clarity by playing the same line an octave higher entirely in the oboe's central register. Now let's hear the oboe line. Can I have Star play the oboe part there? You can play the F is sharp. It's in the F natural. Ta-da. Okay. Yeah, it's... Yeah, play the whole thing. Okay? There we go. Okay. These instruments, by the way, they may sound different than your normal oboes, if any of you have heard orchestras. We're playing with instruments which are replicas of the kinds of instruments that were used during Mozart's and up through Beethoven's time. The Romantics did a real job on these instruments during the collapse of culture in the starting around 1820, and they managed to wipe out a lot of the register shifts. And some of these older instruments are harder to play, but indeed they are much more, when you master them, they can sing much better than a lot of the modern instruments. Okay, now I'd like the sopranos, the mezzo sopranos and the oboe to do it together so we hear this thing. Okay. Okay, let's see if we can do it. Okay? I'll give you 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, almost. Okay, thank you very much. Now, let's take a quick look at the violin. Excuse me, I'm sorry. We're gonna do one more thing before we do that. I just wanted to point out that Haydn and Mozart were the people who did the bulk of the pioneering work on these kinds of octave transpositions. It was never done before. Now the potentials. Let's talk about the stringed instruments: the violin, the viola, the violoncello, and the contrabass. The potentials opened up here are even greater, and potentially more complex. Since each instrument not only can play with its own built-in registral spectroscopy, but can also imitate the registrations of all of the voices of the human chorus. By using different fingerings to shift the location at which the player passes from one string to the next higher or next lower one, the violin instruments can alter which voice type they are imitating. Let's first confine ourselves here to examining the violin. Let's first look at the violin's built-in spectroscopy. Okay. The notes with the holes in them, it's sort of hard to see. Maybe you can point them out. The G, the D, the A, the E. Right. They represent the four open strings with no fingers put down, whereas the other filled-in black notes represent those produced by putting fingers down up to the point indicated by the horizontal red line shown running across the neck of the instrument. Let's hear played on the violin, keeping in mind that when we're passing from one string to the next, we're hearing a modified echo of the register shifts of the human singing voice. And I'd like Nancy to play those just from the G all the way up to the C. Now it shifts. It's a new string. New string. New string. OK. Okay, thank you. Okay, now let's examine how the violin can be fingered to correspond to the spectroscopy of the soprano voice. The next diagram. Okay. To imitate the soprano voice shift from the first to the second register, the violin is now going to have to finger the lowest string all the way up to the F natural, and will then shift to a fingered F sharp or a G on the next neighboring string. Similarly, to imitate the soprano second to third register shift, the player must finger the next to highest string, the A string, up to the F, and then switch to a fingered F sharp or G on the highest string, the E string. Let's hear these two shifts played. What I'd like you to do is don't do the F sharp, just do from just straight, because that way we get the F to the G. F, that's the change, right? And now start from on the A string. There, right? Right. Just play from the high F to the high G, the G, the high F to the high G there. Right. There's a brilliance that occurs between those. These things are subtle, but if you train your ear to hear them, also if you train your ear to hear the subtleties of the shifts of the human singing registers, a whole new world of what music is about begins to open up. So this is precisely what has to be done, the violin section has to do in the opening instrumental passage of the Great Mass by Mozart. The violins, let me have the next one here. Right. The violins present here almost the identical phrase which the sopranos sing later on in the movement, which they did just sing, and which you... And so what I'd like now is for the, let's just have Nancy just do that opening figure, if you can, with the shift there. Shift. Shift. Okay, thank you. Can we go back to the previous figure? It's okay. It should be rather readily apparent from this this diagram here that from the violinist, the player's standpoint, the second to third register shift, the upper one, is more readily fingered because it's lower. It's closer to the open string than the first to the second string. But even this imbalance is turned to good account by the judicious use of octave transpositions. For an example of this, let's turn to the violin part in the opening bars of the Gloria. And the next one, that is skipped, yeah. Okay. Now here, the violin is, which is the top line, there, and then it skips down to the top line, there, is imitating three choral voices in succession. First, the soprano it's imitating, up there, right? You can see it's moving right along with the soprano line. Then the tenor and the alto at octave transposition. All right, so it's moving with different lines, and just it's skipping from measure, almost measure to measure. In the case of the tenor, the violin is imitating the tenor's second to third register shift, right? Right there, yeah. It's where the blue there, yeah. Where it moves from blue to yellow, which lies between F and G, only an octave higher. In the case of the alto, which is the last part there that you see, right. The violin is doing exactly what I showed earlier on that the oboe was doing, i.e. playing the entire phrase on one string, the E string, to preserve the uniregistral quality of the alto's line. Now, I don't want to sing this one. It's going to get a bit complex. You'll hear it. I want to step back for a moment, though. I mean, these we're going through a lot of fine shadings, subtleties here, and some of these may seem very nitpicking or too subtle. I can assure you that they aren't. It's precisely the rigorous attention to this kind of detail which distinguishes a great work of classical art from a piece of arbitrary romantic mush in which everything is blurred like a French impressionist painting. And I want the next slide just to give you an idea of what we're talking about. This is a slide. Oh, I need to hit the button. What do I hit here? Like that? Ah, yes. The features are blurred. The face. I mean, you might say there's a certain amount of prettiness to it, but there's very little. There's almost no real personality shining through this figure. It's all on the surface. There's nothing underneath. There's no beauty underneath this person. As opposed to, I'm going to contrast this with the painstakingly fine tuning of a portrait in the tradition of the Florentine Renaissance. And if you've ever seen this, you can attest that not only is there attention to the detail of the person herself, the Mona Lisa, but also to the background and the relationship that she has to the background. Now, all of the elements I presented so far were developed into a unified creative medium, a kind of a language of classical polyphony, as a result of the revolutionary creative breakthroughs of Wolfgang Mozart during 1782 to 1785. I'd like to devote my remaining time to some musical examples which present the two major components of this revolution. The first component, not in order of time, but in order of priority in Mozart's mind, was the creative breakthrough achieved by his close friend Joseph Haydn in defining a route whereby the problem of the one and the many could be solved in this musical domain. Namely, Haydn found a way to integrate entire movements and implicitly entire multiple movement compositions into a single higher order thought object. Haydn first presented his revolutionary new concept in a series of six string quartets, which he composed in 1781 and published in 1782, the so-called Russian string quartets, Opus 33. Haydn himself commented at the time of their release that after decades of work, he felt he had finally achieved, quote, an entirely new species of composing with these works. The best name for this new approach is not really a noun, but rather a verbal action description in German, Motivführung, a term which literally means motivic leading, but which maybe would be best translated as a governance or an ordering of succession of musical thought objects. But almost in the same breath, I have to reference the second component of Mozart's revolution, Johann Sebastian Bach's solution to a problem which had been confounding generations of previous composers, a problem of establishing a rigorous concept uniting the so-called major and minor modes. Now, what do I mean by major and minor? Well, forget what you've learned about happy major keys and sad minor keys. This is typical romantic stuff that you get on the radio and the commentaries. And think about it as two different geometric domains whose differences can be highlighted by shifting the point in the scale at which the mezzo-soprano changes register. Note, remember in the soprano we had the C scale which was equally split. The mezzo-soprano, which sings the alto line in our chorus, has a very important role in this major-minor shift. Can I have the next overhead after that? Okay, the top line is a descending C minor scale. As you can see, in C minor, the mi, or the third degree from the bottom, right, is in the mezzo-soprano's first, lower first register, whereas in the C major scale, which I have just below there, the same mi falls in the higher or second register. I'd like the mezzo-sopranos to sing both of these, just to make this very clear, okay? Just the mezzo-sopranos. So. Do, si, la, so, fa, mi, re, do. Okay, ready? Okay, and now let's do the C major. Right, okay, thank you. Okay. So the difference between major and minor is already in itself a musical problem or an ambiguity. Bach's solution, which he first presented in his 1747 musical offering, and also later, just before his death in 1750, in his Art of the Fugue, was to pick up on a bit of musical material which had been knocking around for some years, as we can see from the "And With His Stripes" chorus of Handel's 1741 Messiah. Can I have the next figure, please? Maybe we could we have Sylvia and Kathy sing this little figure? Okay. And we. Let's leave it at that. Now that wasn't quite right, but it'll be close. The this material, especially this opening, which we have there, presents the minor mode in the framework of an audibly ambiguous interval. This was worked into a formal scientific challenge by the great military strategist and amateur composer, King Frederick the Great of Prussia. In 1747, Frederick challenged Bach during an historic visit by Bach to Berlin to do the following: compose a six-voice polyphonic setting to the following theme. Can I have the next figure? Okay. Now, I would like this played by two violins. I don't know if you have the... Can you see it, or do I... Is that possible? Like by Nancy and John? It's the three-part Richard Carr. Thank you. Thank you. You can hear that this theme is quite unique, especially the opening part. This do mi sol la si, which is the same as the end with his stripes. And with his stripes. Right. In fact, at that time, many composers. It's different, however. There's some very, very big difference. Many composers would have accused King Frederick at the time even of having broken some of the formal rules of counterpoint by writing an idea which first ascends so high and then descends slowly by these small intervals, because after it goes do mi sol la si, and then all of a sudden it seems to descend in this very slow line, and it's a very difficult challenge. The great master Bach didn't, however, nitpick about the formal violations of classroom music rules in this theme. As a matter of fact, even today, Bach gets attacked for having written this. They say that it's just not correct. It doesn't follow the school books. A major work on this theme, that they attack it. But rather, Bach recognized that it was a revolutionary musical thought object in its own right, and he plunged in to use it to develop a groundbreaking solution, locating the F sharp, i.e. the register shift of the soprano voice, as the focus of a crossover dissonance between the major and the minor keys. And you might notice that the way I've done this here is that you have both superimposed on this theme, both the soprano register shift between the F sharp and the F there. I don't know if you can see that pointed. And then the dotted red line shows also there's a different, there we go. Right. And the dotted red line would be the same theme would shift between the E flat and the E natural at the, if it were sung by a mezzo-soprano voice. So you have both soprano and mezzo somewhat superimposed. Now, for some examples of Haydn's and then Mozart's breakthrough, now that we've dealt with Bach briefly. First, I want to give you a glimpse of Haydn's compositional method before and after his Motivführung breakthrough. If we had more time, I'd present a comparison of a set of six quartets, which Haydn wrote in 1771, the Opus 20 Sun Quartets, with his 1782 Opus 33 Russian Quartets. I invite you to do this on your own, but it's equally fruitful to compare two different Haydn symphonies. His Symphony No. 52, composed around the same time as the early Opus 20 Quartets, and his Symphony No. 78, composed right after he wrote the Opus 33. Let's compare the opening themes of these two symphonies. And what we're going to do now is go to a group from within our orchestra and play each of these opening themes in succession. Okay. And I'm going to have to conduct these from the podium. That was the earlier one, and now I want to just play the with the next one. I want to play the opening, just the opening of the other later symphony, number 78. Both are in C minor. Both deal with the same material. I hope you can recognize that, as we saw worked up in the royal theme. At the time Haydn wrote the earlier symphony, it's very doubtful that Haydn had any knowledge of Bach's musical offering, which had been all but suppressed by enemy operations following Bach's death in 1750. But in the later symphony, we definitely see the influence of Bach's discoveries, which had been brought back from Berlin to Vienna by the diplomat Baron Gottfried von Swieten. Von Swieten had spent the previous years in Berlin negotiating with Prussia concerning the future disposition of Bosnia within the Austrian Empire. And during that time, he'd been recruited by a small group of Bach admirers who had a sense of the revolution Bach's works could spark, if only those works got into the right hands in Vienna, which turned out to be Mozart's hands. So there's a world of difference between these two presentations. The earlier symphony's theme is relatively barren of ambiguities. Let me have the first one. All right. In the second measure, for instance, the chief emphasis falls once again on C. Bum, dum, dum, bum. Just, it seems to, while the register shift to the G is carelessly glossed over. Dum, ding, dum, dum, bum. And the second half of the opening theme adds little by way of new ambiguities. This is dum. And the F sharp is conspicuously absent. There's no F sharp anywhere. And later, Symphony number 78, on the other hand, Haydn dramatically highlights a register shift in the second measure. Right. Dum, bum, bum, dum, bum. All those are register shifts. Bum, bum. The second poetic line has a poignantly placed F sharp. I'm sorry. There it is, that F sharp. And is preceded also by this highly dissonant D-flat. Now, Haydn's Motivführung breakthrough comes into focus when we compare the three thematic, these are just the first thematic statements that we have here. You've got to compare the three thematic statements in the first movement of both symphonies. We can label these statements A, B, and C, with A consisting of the opening statements we've just heard. Now, before we pick them out, I think the best thing to do is to just listen to the entire first section of each of these symphonies. First, what we want to do is play through the opening, introductory, you might call it, section of the symphony, first movement of the Symphony 52.